But we are a little specific, really. Luke chapter 21, verse 34 is our text today. And as we look there, we're going to talk about submission to authority. And I think the mic will work into that for us. In Luke chapter 21, and verse 34 through 38, through the end of that chapter. And that'll be our text today. As we've been doing, we've been looking at the greatest week in history, the Passion Week, as reported for us in the book of Luke. On Sunday mornings, I've been sharing with you a particular section of Scripture, and on Sunday night, we've been kind of going a little deeper into that, and looking a little more closely. And if you want to know the honest truth today, I do not have an introduction for you. I'm going to go right into the sermon. But tonight, if you'll come back, I'll give you my introduction. It just takes 20 minutes, you know. And so that'll be our introduction. Tonight we'll do the introduction. Today we're going to do the message. But you come back and be with us as we share together from this Passion Week. Luke's narrative gives us some basic information and gives us some applicable things for our lives today as we talk about submission to authority. We'll talk about that because this section of Scripture speaks of authority. Because in this section of Scripture, thanks guys, in this section of Scripture, Jesus' authority is challenged. So let's read Luke chapter 21 and verse 34. Be on your guard, so that your minds are not dulled from carousing, drunkenness, and worries of life. Or that day will come on you unexpectedly, like a trap. For it will come on all who live on the face of the whole earth. But be alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape all these things that are going to take place and to stand before the Son of Man. During the day, he was teaching in the temple complex. But in the evening, he would go out and he would spend the night on what is called the Mount of Olives. But all the people would come early in the morning to hear him in the temple complex. Verse 34 says, be on your guard. Your minds are not to be dulled, because those days are going to come like a trap. And it'll come on all who live. But you be alert at all times, praying that you may have strength to escape. Submitting ourselves to the authority of Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for the reading of your word. And thank you, Father, for the opportunity to share it today. I pray, Lord, that you'd hide me behind the cross of Calvary. And I pray, Father, that your people would see and hear you today. And Lord, as they do, I pray their lives would be changed. Father, I pray that we would all be seen as under your authority. And we'll give you thanks for what you're going to do in these next few moments. And it's in your name that we pray and we all say, amen. First of all, I want to talk to you about Christ being Lord. Christ being Lord. Read with me, if you will take your Bibles, read them with me from chapter 20 and verse 1. Chapter 20 and verse 1. And it came to pass that on those days, as he taught the people in the temple and preached the gospel, the chief priests and the scribes came upon him with the elders. They spake to him, saying, tell us, by what authority do you do these things that you do? And who is it that gave you this authority? And he answered him, he said, I will also ask you one thing. And you answer me. The baptism of John, was it from heaven or men? Verse 5. And they reasoned with themselves, saying, if we shall say from heaven, he will say, why then believe ye him not? But if we say of men, all the people will stone us. For they are persuaded that John was a great prophet. Verse 7. And they answered that they could not tell who it was from. And Jesus said unto them, neither tell I you by what authority I do these things. You see, all these well-being, well-bred, well-taught, well-educated men came before Jesus and they asked him what his authority was. where his authority had come from. They do this because they have no relationship with the one who sent Jesus. They have no fellowship with the Father of light. And therefore, walking in darkness, they are unable to see the impacting difference that Jesus Christ can make. Jesus, my friends, is Lord. There is no question about it. It's period. It's not Jesus is Lord and, or Jesus is Lord but, or Jesus is Lord and I'll add this. It's Jesus is Lord, period. There is no other beside him. There is no other above him. Verse 14 of John chapter 14 says that if you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, you keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees him not, neither knows him. But you know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless, I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you see me, because I live, and ye shall live also. At that day, ye shall know that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loves me, and he that loves me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. Take notice, my friends, of verse 21 of John chapter 14. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. The business owner in Texas would change his sign periodically, and he would put on this sign spiritual or scriptural lessons for those who passed by. One day, on his sign, he had simply put two words, "Yes, Lord." Yes, Lord. That's all he put. You see, instead of asking questions, these well-bred, well-taught, religious leaders should have been saying, "Yes, Lord." And my friends, we ought to be saying the very same things today. Yes, Lord, I'll commit my life to you. Yes, Lord, I'll be content where I am instead of wishing I were somewhere else. Yes, Lord, I'll trust you for the outcome of the uncertainty that gnaws at my mind. Yes, Lord, I'll open my heart and I'll open my hand with joyous generosity of love to others. Jesus said, "He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest myself to him." Listen, there is no barrier, there is no burden to the obligation in that. Just the eager response of love makes Jesus Christ Lord. It's the principle of Christ's Lordship, which is the master key that unlocks every other doctrine of the Word of God. You see, you and I see in the remainder of this message today, we're going to have an understanding of and a response to the Lordship of Christ. I want to show you how we do that. I want to show you how Christ affects the whole of our life and the whole of our ministry. You see, a person's confession of Jesus as Lord involves the unseen spiritual aspects of life as well as the physical aspects of life. If you're not aware of it by now, you're going to learn that we live a major battlefield in our lives. And that battlefield is of the mind and of the heart. The decisions made in our heart and in our mind will invariably and inevitably be displayed in our lives. We see this ever so clearly in Luke chapter 9, verse 57 through 62. It's where Jesus Christ is called Lord three times. Christ's lordship over a person's life, his physical life, is most important. You see, I'm told that the late Dr. Adrian Rogers used to lay in his bed each morning, and he used to tear off every part of his body, and he would give it to Christ's service in the kingdom of God. In Christ was Lord of his life. My question today is Christ Lord of all of your actions? Is Christ Lord of all of your attitudes? Is Christ Lord of all of your language? Is Christ Lord of all your possessions? Christ is not the Lord of a person's life unless he is the Lord of everything. Oh, Christian friend, you have been bought at the price of the blood of Jesus Christ. As such, Christ's lordship implies ownership. Florence Nightingale, you remember her? That great nurse. She was a renowned nurse. At the age of 30 years old, she submitted her life so completely to the lordship of Jesus Christ that she was asked later in life about the secret of her fruitful career, and she said, "I held nothing back from God." Listen, Nightingale's answer is what the answer needs to be from us. If Jesus Christ is Lord of our lives, there's nothing we'll hold back from him. You see, not only does Christ's lordship imply ownership, but Christ's lordship also implies obedience. The Luke 9 passage reveals those three tests of obedience. It's the test of poverty, the test of urgency, the test of sovereignty. In the first test, a man offers to follow Jesus Christ, but Jesus replies to him, "The Son of Man doesn't even have a home." In the test of urgency, another man offers to follow Jesus Christ after his father's death. And Jesus urges that man to follow him immediately. Listen, it is best to say it this way. Delayed obedience is disobedience.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Can you say it again? Mm-hmm. Delayed obedience is disobedience.
That's right.
You see, when God calls, he calls. And he calls now. When he gives us an assignment, there's a nowness to that assignment. There's an urgency to it. Here's the third test. The third test is the sovereignty of God. A man offers to follow Jesus, but he desires to bid farewell to his family first. This man had divided loyalties. He was hesitant to give up his allegiance to his family so that he could give his full allegiance to Christ. I submit to you, my friends, that if Jesus Christ's lordship is the master key to doctrine, then we should be preaching the lordship of Christ, and we should be living the lordship of Christ. Roger Wilmore, the pastor of the Deerfoot Baptist Church in Trustville, Alabama, said a few years ago, "In a day when the preeminence of Christ is challenged and debated, we need to preach the lordship of Jesus. In a day when Christians are malnourished and spiritually anemic, in a day when we seek to be culturally relevant rather than Christ-honoring, in a day when Christians are more concerned about satisfying self and seekers than they are the Savior, we need to preach the lordship of Jesus Christ." Amen and amen. The resolution of every trouble that we face today begins with our trusting response to our Savior, "Yes, Lord." You can never go wrong. You can never go wrong when you choose to be owned, when you choose to obey, when you choose to be obligated to Jesus Christ. And friends, once we've settled the issue of lordship in our lives, then Christ is expected. I want you to turn with me to chapter 21 of Luke. And follow along with me as we begin to read verse 25. "And there shall be signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity. The sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up. Lift up your head, for your redemption draweth nigh." As a believer, my friends, as a believer, and when Jesus Christ is Lord of our lives, we are always on the lookout for the return of Jesus Christ. You see, I am very firm in my belief that in these days, the followers and the listeners of Jesus Christ need to notice the urgency of the hour. We need to notice that we are living in last days. A friend of mine said the other day when he answered the phone, he said, "Hey, Jeff, have you heard a trumpet sound today?" And I thought for a minute, and I was in Birmingham traffic, and I thought about how it would be wonderful if I had heard a trumpet sound at that moment. But I said, "No, JT, I haven't. But even so, Lord Jesus, come." Listen, we ought to live in joyful anticipation of the return of Jesus Christ. We're awaiting His return. Jesus Christ admonished His believers and His followers to be prepared. "Watch therefore, for you know not what hour the Lord may come. Therefore be ye also ready, for in such an hour as you think not the Son of Man will come." Any hour, any time, any minute, any second, Christ can return. Are you ready? If you are, then here's the third thing. Christ will be honored. You see, if Christ is Lord, you're going to be ready. And if you're going to be ready, Christ is going to be honored. Go back to Ephesians chapter 21. Let's read verses 1 through 4. And he looked up and he saw the rich men casting their gifts into the treasury. And he saw also a certain poor widow casting in her 2 mites. And he said, "Of a truth I say unto you, that this poor widow has cast in more than all of you. For all these have of their abundance cast in unto the offerings of God. But she has cast in all the living that she had." Now, we could stay right here forever and take this section of Scripture and we could tear it apart. We could spend a couple of hours right here. But I'm just going to say this. The rich men were casting in their great sums of money in the collection plate. They were doing it so all could see what great givers they were. And they were honoring themselves, not God. They were giving so that others might see and so that others might applaud them. The widow, on the other hand, she gave all that she had. She gave 2 worthless coins. It was all that she had. It may very well have been the last vestige of anything of worth that she had. But she did. And she didn't do it so that others might see. She didn't do it so that others might hear it when it clinks in the metal of the collection plate. She did it because that was important to her. She did it because she wanted to honor God with what she had. I was walking through the den the other day and there was 2 pennies laying on the floor. I left them there. They were right at the edge of the hearth of the fireplace. And so I just left them there. I came back through later. There had been several people in and out and through the den. And those 2 pennies were still there. My friend, I submit to you that if that had been $100 bill, my daughter would have killed herself to get to the hearth and pick up that $100 bill. I submit to you that if it had been a $5 bill, Granny would have fallen out of her wheelchair just to get. I submit to you that if it had been $1, my wife would have picked it up and stuffed it in her pocket. But it was 2 worthless pennies. When I was walking through a department store, I noticed that I walked into the department store, and I noticed that in the planners right here in front of the department store, there were pennies just everywhere, and on both sides. They weren't to be. Now, what they don't understand is that two pennies can make $200 real quick. I mean, all you have to do is put them together. And a dollar's worth of pennies in a roll times 10 is money, right? But two by themselves, not much. You can't even buy a gun anymore for two pennies. The word of God is all that she has. Listen, Christian friend, it's not what you give, but it's what you keep that matters. And you want to honor God, and you want to give as God needs. But what you keep must honor Him as well. You see, the Pharisees and the Sadducees and all the religious folk, they may have given their great gifts, but their heart and their life was far from God. They were whitewashed tombs, the Scripture says. They were empty cups, the Scripture says. They were soundless trumpets, the Word of God says. You see, the gift did not match the walk. The actions of their life was not as grand as the gift that they threw into the collection plate. You know, they were willing to give a lot, but they weren't willing to give everything. She, on the other hand, the widow, was willing to allow the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to be her King and her Lord, and she gave all that she had. In Christ Jesus, I ask you, is He honored in all that you do? In the little that you have, or in the abundance that you retain? Is it the little things that matter, really? Yes, it's the little things that matter. That's why when you and I allow the Lord to be Lord of our lives, when we allow Him to be honored in our lives, we will allow Him to be seen in our lives. Go back to Luke chapter 21, verse 29 and 30. The Scripture reads this way, and He's speaking to them a parable. Behold, the fig tree and all the trees. When you see the shoot come forth, and you know yourselves that summer is now nigh at hand. The fig tree is prominent in the Passion Week narrative. You see, Jesus had encountered a fig tree, and it had leaves, and the fig tree looked good, and the fig tree looked as if it produced a lot of fruit. But Jesus' anticipation did not match what He was about to see. For you see, Jesus was going to lift those leaves, and He was going to take some fruit, and He was going to eat in it. And He might have allowed somebody to harvest the fruit from that fig tree and make them some fig preserves. Not a real fond fig preserve either, but some of you are, I know. But when Jesus Christ took that beautiful, lush, leaf, glinting in the noonday sun, He lifted it, and there was no fruit. It appeared to be alive, but it was dead. It appeared to be producing, but it wasn't. It appeared to be just right, but it wasn't. Leaves, but no fruit. And this was disappointing to the Master. Sure, it was pretty. Sure, it was alive. Sure, it looked good. Yet there was no fruit. The appearance of life, but no produce. The appearance of hope, but not hopeful. The appearance of living, but dead. But this fruit is needful. It gives evidence that what is seen on the outside is producing life on the inside. Jesus said that you might sound good. Jesus said you may preach good. Jesus said that you may do all the things necessary that you need to do to look alive and well and in Christ. But without love, you are nothing. Paul said that without works there is no use to even talk a good game. Listen, the Scripture says, as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without work is dead. Back to the fig tree. The Scripture says that Jesus cursed that fig tree. He said that it would never produce leaves again. and when the Savior encounters that tree again, along with the disciples and some of his followers, the tree was withered and dead. There was no life in the roots, there was no life in the stalk, there was no life in the leaves, and it was dead as could be, dead as a doornail. Does that sound familiar? We as believers are to have life, right? We're not just to have the appearance of life, but we're to have life in looks and acts. We're to do all that we do for the glory of God in words and deeds. Some are seen as faithful believers. They go to church, they act like Christians and worship. But indeed, throughout the week, their life does not reflect Jesus Christ. It doesn't reflect anything of God. It doesn't reflect anything of His Word. It doesn't reflect anything of His ways. How sad. How truly sad that is. No wonder some say that they will become a believer even when not for believers. We allow Christ to be seen in all that we are, in all that we have, in all that we do. You see, for Jesus Christ to be seen in our life, we must be willing to spend time with Him. That's the last point Christ has sought. Once more, go with me to Luke chapter 21, verse 38. The scripture says, all the people came early in the morning to Him in the temple for to hear Him. They're seeking Jesus Christ. And they are captivated by His teaching. They want to hear what He has to say. There's a difference between what they were and what we are to be. Many of these will be the ones who stand in the crowd and they turn against Him. They're going to shout out their accusations about Jesus. They're going to shout out their desires that He should be sent to the cross and to die. And even though they spent time hearing the message of love and hope and faith and life, they're still going to turn their back on Jesus. Listen, we're to seek Him, and we're to seek His teaching. We're to submit ourselves to His authority in our life. We're to live in such a way that others will know that we've been in His presence. In Acts, we see this so clearly. The scripture says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship. Listen, I encourage you, seek Him out. And you do this through Bible study, and you do this through Sunday school, and you do this through worship, and you do this through your private prayer time. You seek Him out. Hear Him in all that you do. Hear Him in many ways. You, my friends, will be better because of the time you spent with God. This is the way that we demonstrate the authority of Christ in our life. Because you see, as I see it, this is the problem with the world today. Amen? If Christ is Lord of a believer's life, if Christ is honored in the life of the believer, if Christ is sought in the life of the believer, if Christ is seen in the life of the believer, it'll change this world. Jesus said that if He be lifted up, He'll draw all men to Himself. He'll be glorified. So my question today is, actually two questions. Is Jesus Lord of your life? Is He Lord in everything? Have you consciously, determinedly made Him the supreme authority in your life? If not, then today, say, Lord, I know You're Savior, but I call You Lord, and consciously, I've not made You the supreme authority in my life. So, Lord, You're in charge now. You're at the center of my life. You have all authority in my life. If Jesus Christ is not Savior of your life, then He cannot be Lord. He has to be Savior first. So you need to give your heart to Him today. Confess Him as Savior. Repent of your sin. Believe in Him. And you will be saved.